My wife, for example, who is Russian, she catches it from the air, and her spoken English is much better than mine. But she cannot understand written English. She cannot read Joyce or Shakespeare, and I'm just vice versa. I never understand a word in American films.
Absolutely.
If there are, there is a possibility to look at the Lord of the Rings, or let us say Star Wars, with subtitles in English. Then I understand everything. But if I listen, I don't understand. So this is my big problem. At present, not so big, because I spend more than half of my time in Europe, not in the United States, but I never became a real American. So from time to time, maybe some translation should be necessary. Thank you.
May I ask a question?
Yes,
I have one and a half question. One short, Miłosz translated only your work from Lithuanian, or he translated from Lithuanian?
Yes.
Yes. It was only your works, or he translated anything else?
She. Umka Gerasimova.
No.
Miłosz.
Ah, Miłosz. Did Miłosz translate?
Because you mentioned that he translated one.
He translated one my poem, which was published in Kultura, as I
said. Was it from English? From
that was
Lithuanian?
From Lithuanian. Miłosz understood Lithuanian. Not exactly, but he could understand, for example, a newspaper article. Mm-hmm. He always read the gospel in Lithuanian.
Oh,
he knew gospel by heart, and it was not difficult for him to understand it. He remembered some Lithuanian from his childhood.
I see.
But he was shy of speaking Lithuanian, and never wrote anything in Lithuanian. Although I believe he could. Yes, if one would tell him, Mr. Miłosz will shoot you, or you write a poem in Lithuanian, he probably could manage. The same happened to William Butler Yeats, who knew Gaelic. But then Miłosz, I don't think Miłosz in his early youth, Miłosz translated a poet whose name was Kazis Boruta. Mm-hmm. Kazis Boruta belonged to the generation of my father. He was a leftist, but a fairly good poet, I would say. And there were the very first translations by Miłosz into Polish. Then later he translated many, many poets, but only to Lithuanians. Boruta, five or six poems in his early youth, and one of my own poems. Then he was asked by Lithuanians during the independence movement to translate the anthem of Lithuania, Lietuva tėvynė mūsų, Lithuania my fatherland, into Polish. He tried but did not succeed. And in his papers there are some attempts to translate this Lithuanian anthem.
One more question.
Yes.
I always admire your essay on Zanavies, which is altar curtain. And when I, much later, I visited Lublin, and there is in the museum a curtain, altar curtain, of Władysław Jagiełło mother. And when I look at this and I read and I remember your essay, mm-hmm. I realized she was Christian.
Who?
His mother.
I guess, yes.
Yes, right?
Yes.
So, thanks to your essay,
I
could, and this is beautiful.
I will explain you something. Lithuania was a pagan country, the last pagan country in Europe. Which was baptized only at the very end of the 14th century, by Jagiełło, mm-hmm. by Jagiełło. Mm. So, and we are rather proud of it, that we are such strange people who were pagans when everybody around was Christian. So there were, Lithuania was usually, well, when there was a very strange monarchy in Lithuania, which was actually a diarchy. There were always two grand dukes. Well, not always, but quite frequently there were two grand dukes, brothers or cousins, who ruled the country together. One of those brothers was Kęstutis or Kęstut, whose son was Witold or Witoldas. Kęstutis was a very, very strong, yes, a pagan of very strong kind, so to speak, was never baptized and married a pagan girl whose name was Birutė or Biruta. That was a famous marriage, and their son was Witold or Witoldas, the biggest hero of Lithuania, who took part in the Grunwald battle. And Jagiello also took part in the Grunwald battle.
On the other side.
But Jagiello was different. Jagiello's father was Algirdas or Olgerd, Kęstut's brother, who remained a pagan, but he married a Russian Orthodox lady, whose name was Yuliania, or Uliana, if you want. She was Christian, but she married a pagan duke. She had a church, she attended church, but he never attended. And they produced Jagiello or Jogaila, whose mother was Christian and whose father was pagan, who himself remained pagan as his father, but later he embraced Christianity and became a king of Poland.
Have you known that her garden is in Lublin? Have you ever heard?
In Lublin Museum or where?
Lublin Museum.
No, I did not know it. Well, but for example, when Jagiello or Jogaila, we call him Jogaila, which means, by the way, in Polish it does not mean anything. In Lithuanian it has a meaning from Joti and Galeti, a person who can write, a good writer, a cowboy, so to speak. And Jagiello was a good writer, Witold was also. So then, when Jagiello came to Lublin, he brought with him painters who painted frescoes in Lublin. Those frescoes were in Russian style, in style of Russian Orthodox painting. They are still there, they can be seen. It's a very unusual sight. Orthodox frescoes on the Gothic, walls. So that's, but I did not see this curtain.
Mm-hmm. May I ask a question?
Yes.
You mentioned all this wonderful correspondence with Trauberg. Did I understand it correctly that it's been published now?
Well, you see, yes, it has been, well, first of all, when Trauberg died, unfortunately she died several years ago, her daughter, whom I know very well, I remember her as a baby, now she is a lady, and a translator and partly a writer herself, she found my letters in Trauberg's archive, and she decided to publish them. In a limited edition. There was a limited, generally a samizdat edition, although today we have no samizdat because everything can be published. But she published it in a limited typescript edition of 10 copies. But then Unka took part of that edition and published it in this book. Well, I'm really unhappy that I cannot offer the book for you maybe next time, because I will have several dozens of copies of it. Okay?
It's a kind of complimentary question, and I'm afraid that Natalia's letters didn't survive.
Sorry?
Natalia's letters didn't survive. Natasha's, you know, she obviously... I knew her, that's why I'm calling, saying Natasha, but...
You knew Natasha?
Yeah, I was Natasha's kind of very youngish friend of Natasha.
Natasha's letter did survive. They are in the Pinecke Library at Yale. They are very difficult to decipher. But there is a project to publish the entire correspondence as a sort of a literary monument, as a correspondence of I don't know whom, Block with Evgeny Ivanov or something like that. So maybe we will do it. But her letters all survived as well, but only my part has been published.
Does Lithuanian have articles?
No. Lithuania does not have articles, and for that reason, I usually don't use articles when I speak English.
May I ask?
Yes.
I wanted to ask you to talk a little bit about how you worked with your, how you have worked with your translators, different ones, from Brodskiego to Milos, you said already. Ending with your work, your collaboration with Unka, Anya Gerasimova on this book.
I can tell you, I was lucky with translators because, for example, well, no one else but Joseph Brodsky translated some of my work into Russian. And also Kushner, also Gorbanevska, quite good poets, quite good poets. Then, and into Polish, I was translated into Polish by Milos, one poem, and by Stanislav Baranczyk, who was probably the best Polish translator of all times. Now, well, now my poetry is translated into Polish, my new work is translated into Polish by Beata Kalemba. Beata Kalemba is a scholar, and she knows Lithuanian. She translates from the original. Milos translated, he understood Lithuanian, as I have said, of course not every word and not every sentence, but he understood Lithuanian. But he was helped in his translation by a certain Rafael Seely, by an English linguist who knew Lithuanian and who was active at Berkeley. Baranczyk did not know Lithuanian, but I prepared for him the word-for-word translations with lots of comments. The same happened with Brodsky. Who did not know Lithuanian? Well, maybe several words, but not much. So I prepared the word-for-word translation with comments, also marking the meter and the places of rhymes, the rhyming scheme. And then Brodsky or Vladimir Gandersman or Gorbanevsky or Kushner or Viktor Kule, there were several translators, they did their best for translating. I looked at the translation and sometimes I said, well, here I have in mind something different. Then they changed it. But as a rule, the translations were even better than their originals. Now I have a really good translator who knows Lithuanian, who makes some small errors in Lithuanian, but her Lithuanian is pretty good. And we work together because she sends me several variants of the text. I choose the best variant, in my opinion, and sometimes also tell her that, well, here I had in mind something a bit different. Then she corrects it. It's much more, well, Diana, by the way, Diana Seneschal knows Russian and knows Lithuanian. So she works with the original. But Ellen Hinsey, for example, does not know either Russian or Lithuanian, so it's the same problem to preparing word-for-word translations and then working together. I never tried to translate myself into either Russian or English or Polish or any language. I wrote one or two poems.